morning. I'd like to welcome all of you to the opening session of Plymouth's annual and special town meetings. They're being held this morning, Saturday, April 1st, 2017. It's 8 a.m. and we're at Plymouth North High School, which is located on Aubrey Street in Plymouth. And at this time, I'd like to invite everyone to please join us in a salute to the flag to be led by Troops 64 under the direction of John Goslick and Troop 9 Ramblers, Boy Scouts, under the direction of James McCormick, to be followed by our national anthem to be performed by Laura Francis from Plymouth South High School.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now, the national anthem will be performed by Laura Francis.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Our invocation will now be offered by Reverend Michael Dunphy.
Please join me, if you will. Holy God, known by many names and worshiped in a myriad of traditions, may your blessing rest upon this meeting. In a world where people can be less than civil, may our words today be fashioned with respect and moderation. And while self-interest appears fashionable, may our thoughts and concerns today remain focused on what is best for this precious community. We are grateful for those who continue to give generously of their time and their expertise for the well-being of this town. Hear this, our humble prayer, O God. Amen.
At this time, we invite Town Clerk Lawrence Pizer to read the in memoriam record for the past year of town officials and employees who have passed away. Mr. Pizer.
George Alves, Sewer Department. Gary Anderson, teacher. Dana Paul Blanchard, Assistant Pump Station Operator, Water Department. Wilbert Singolani, principal. James Cotter, firefighter. Vincent DiClemente, assistant director of technical studies. Agnes Farrow, school aide and also custodian. Philip Furtado, DPW maintenance. Guido Garaldi, custodian. John P. Hansen, Jr., police officer. Dennis H. Hassan, Jr., police officer. Ernest Leonardi, police chief. John Lee, teacher and town meeting member. Ronald Lindquist, custodian. John Medeiros, recreation director. William J. Murphy, Jr., police chief. F. Edward Nicholas, superintendent. Monica P. Pinto, paraprofessional. Elizabeth A. Ragazzini, secretary. Robert L. Reggiani, sewer department. Clement L. Robson, Jr., cremationist. Antonio T. J. Ruggiero, firefighter. Edward L. Zanaboni, DPW, heavy motor vehicle operator. Margaret Zanaboni, principal. Let's also take a special moment to remember our fellow town meeting member, Robert Cunningham.
Reverend Dunphy.
As we have listened to these names, we cannot help but remember the impact their lives have had on this town. In our gratitude, we are reminded of the words from the psalmist of old, "Teach us to count our days, that we, each one of us, might gain a heart of wisdom." We are grateful beyond measure for those who have served you by serving the people around them. May they rest in peace and dwell with God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. This time I'd like to invite scouts to come forward, led by Cy Beltrand, for a special presentation to Kenneth Tavares, chair of the Plymouth Board of Selectmen. Cy Beltrand.
In 1957, when Vice President Nixon came to the town for the Mayflower II to be launched, this banner was hanging up in town, and it was recently found at the old police station before it was torn down, and Troop 64 wanted to present this to Mr. Tavares.
We will carry this banner to the new town hall and properly display it during the 400th anniversary. I'm very appreciative. I know the scouts found this when they were helping to clean out the station, and it's going to be treasured by us. Incidentally, I was here in 1957 and watched the Mayflower come in, but I don't remember this flying, but we'll do it again. And also at this time, Mr. Moderator, I just want to take a minute to thank these young people that have opened the program today. You know, there are times when we as a community get a little bit down, and on a day like today, it's even easier to do that. But when you see the enthusiasm of the scouts, of the beautiful singing talents of Laura, and she represents so many other people in the community, we can indeed be proud. And to our young people, let's give them another round of applause. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Town Clerk Lawrence Pizer has advised that we have a quorum of at least 90 elected town meeting members, and I therefore declare that a quorum being present, the Plymouth annual town meeting will come to order at 8:10 a.m. And at this time, We'd like to, if there are no objections, Mr. Brian Alosi will continue as the assistant town moderator for this town meeting. Mr. Pizer, do we have any new town meeting members to swear in? We do not. So at this time, I'd like to welcome our legislative delegation led by Senator Vinnie DiMacedo. And Senator Vinnie DiMacedo is joined by State Representative Matthew Muratori. Welcome, Senator DiMacedo and Representative Muratori.
Good morning, and thank you, Mr. Moderator, Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, and town meeting members for inviting us to give you an update on what's happening on Beacon Hill over this past year. Again, in the interest of time, I will again be speaking on behalf of the entire delegation. You can applaud now because of that. I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. I know it's early. I'm sorry. Representative Matt Muratori, Representative Tom Coulter, and Representative Randy Hunt. Representative Muratori is here. The other two of the delegation were not able to attend today. We have recently completed the 189th legislative session, and we are in the early stages of the 190th session. I'd like to begin by taking a moment to look back at some of the achievements that the legislature accomplished over the past 2 years. Working together with Governor Baker and the legislature, we have successfully enacted legislation that has taken a giant step forward in addressing the opiate epidemic throughout the Commonwealth. Through increased spending on addiction services by 50% over the past two years, hundreds of additional treatment beds have come online, and there have been increased family and peer support groups across the Commonwealth. And while we're on this topic, I'd be remiss if I didn't congratulate our own police chief, Chief Botieri, for Project Outreach, a program that he has put in place that is serving as a statewide model for outreach for those affected by the opiate addiction. We as a state are far ahead of any other state in the union. As I am sure you have heard, our own governor was recently received a presidential appointment to an opiate panel as a result of our leadership on this issue in the Commonwealth. Another significant piece of legislation we dealt with was the creation of the MBTA Fiscal and Management Control Board. I'm going to give you just a few numbers to talk about how effective it was. In FY 2016, the projected deficit from the previous administration was supposed to be $170 million above and beyond the $1 billion that the state puts in as a match for the $2 billion program. With some of the tools that they've received, the legislation, that deficit was only $86 million. In FY 2017, it was going to be $242 million deficit. It ended up only being $50 million. And in FY 2018, it was going to be $335 million, and it is now projected to be zero. You get the point. The reality is, as this legislation saved the Commonwealth a significant amount of money, which has been able to be poured back into programs as well as new equipment for the MBTA. Additionally, without any new funding, the RMV has successfully undergone significant improvements through improving their online resources as well as implementing more efficient customer service practices. They have successfully cut wait times to an average of less than 30 minutes per visit, and you're able to get out the door much faster now. We also passed an economic development bond bill that allocated $500 million for MassWorks grants and a variety of economic development tools. As you may recall, that program is how we were able to secure $2 million for the Cordage Park improvements, which you can already start to see, and $2 million for the restoration of the T Wharf, which is ongoing now. We also passed an energy bill that still keeps Massachusetts at the forefront of renewable energy while requiring competitive bidding to keep those prices reasonable. In that bill, we were able to include a 21-member nuclear decommissioning advisory panel, which will be tasked with overseeing the safe decommissioning of Pilgrim. Just a few months ago, The governor included $120,000 to fund this commission, and they have begun to appoint members, including individuals from this town. With all the good things that we've accomplished over the last session, we still do have challenges ahead. The first big issue that we are going to be facing is the issue of implementing a new marijuana law that was voted on by the voters. I have had the privilege of being appointed to this committee, although my mother's not that impressed with the fact that I'm on the Marijuana Policy Committee, and have been working with the delegation and my colleagues to put together a comprehensive piece of legislation that will address on the issues of local control, public safety, and public health, while still at the same time respecting the will of the voters. Another issue that we are facing is addressing the increased cost of mass health based on per pupil costs, and the fact that the amount of people using mass health that subsidize health care in Massachusetts has continued to grow. We have now reached 30% of our population. Next year, mass health will cost $700 million more. $600 million is because of the increased enrollment. In 2007, 1/6 of the state was enrolled in mass health. This year, almost 1/3 of the state is enrolled. We are seeing a shift away from private pay insurance to publicly subsidized health care at an alarming rate. When next year's entire budget is predicated on a 3.9% revenue growth totaling approximately $1.1 billion, having $700 million carved out for one line item leaves the rest of the entire state budget with only a little over $400 million to address all of the other needs in education, public safety, environment, affordable housing, et cetera. We could be talking here about a lot more, but however, I understand that you have a lot of work to do addressing your budget concerns and the needs for this community. So I simply extend to you, as I always do, our willingness as a delegation to be your advocates on Beacon Hill and to continue to do all the hard work of making sure that this wonderful community continues to grow and thrive. So again, on behalf of the entire delegation, with Representative Muratori here as well, thank you for your commitment and work on behalf of America's hometown. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
Thank you, Senator Vinnie DiMaceto. Thank you, Representative Muratori. This time, we invite Kenneth Tavares to speak as chair of the Plymouth Board of Selectmen on his State of the Town message. Welcome, Mr. Tavares.
Thank you. Mr. Moderator, town meeting members, elected and appointed officials, and fellow citizens, on behalf of Selectman Provenzano, Mahoney, Page, and Joyce, good morning and welcome to this annual town meeting. Given the busy warrants you have before you, I will briefly touch on a few challenges, achievements, and opportunities that lie ahead. First, some good news. Our fiscal strength is sound and enviable. The latest town bond rating is a strong AA+. This rating will aid us when we go out soon for upcoming borrowings that include Plymouth South High School, the Town Hall, the T Wharf, and other town projects previously approved by this body. Concerns with pension liabilities and other post-employment benefits are being addressed under the watchful eye of our able finance director, who, with your assistance, keeps our town on a solid financial footing. Our form of government provides the opportunity for strong citizen participation. The demands of a growing community are many and require a sound vetting process. Today, with your public input and deliberation, this meeting will consider a proposal that will begin to deal with our road challenges. It is our common goal to provide services such as this at a reasonable cost. The Pilgrim Nuclear Plant continues to be front and center in our work as we think about safety and long-term fuel storage. The plant, after its scheduled June 2019 closing date, will still remain an economic component to our local economy. The 1,500 plus acres owned by Entergy could provide us with an opportunity. In late May, the State Citizens Advisory Panel that includes local residents will convene to address the many complex issues about the plan. Without a doubt, I assure you that this Board of Selectmen will continue to fight for removal of that nuclear waste to a federal depository. A promise by the feds has been broken. The federal government needs to address safe storage of nuclear waste. And as I mentioned, in the fall of 2015, the town has been preparing for the economic impact of the plant closing. In 1997, tax revenue from the plant peaked at over $15 million, which represented 20% of our budget. Today, the revenue of $9.25 million represents just under 5% of our budget. Since deregulation, when the town was forced by the legislature to negotiate pilot agreements, this community has steadily diversified our tax base, effectively reducing our reliance on the plant. There is increased recognition of Plymouth from state and federal agencies about what makes the desirable, what makes the town desirable to so many. The money we received from the state-of-the-art, soon-to-be-completed TWOF for the Cordage Park development and for our numerous environmental projects are all a testament to the vision we as a community have planned for and put forth. By way of example, the new town wharf will help support our emerging aquaculture, which has seen 80 acres of oyster beds opened, creating many new jobs, and our existing lobster fleet, the second largest in the Commonwealth, with over 1 million pounds of lobster landing each year. The Cordage Park development has been decades in the making. You don't believe me, ask Charlie Vandini. The $2 million grant from the state has the potential to translate into $27 million in private development and revitalize that section of North Plymouth. Also worth mentioning are the new town hall, Water Street improvements, and our state-of-the-art new high schools. And when you think about the future, one only needs to look at the recent study done by Northeastern University on Plymouth. It identified areas of needed improvement and those of strength. The study cited our workforce composition, physical attractiveness, and business services as what we are getting right. Plymouth covers all those bases and more that's evident in the report, and these things do not happen by accident. It takes the collective effort of the entire community. To all of you, a job well done and continuing. In less than 3 years, the eyes of the world will be upon us as we commemorate Plymouth's 400th anniversary. Dates for the 2020 signature events and programs have been finalized with a full rollout of the events in May of this year. The 35-member state commission appointed by Governor Baker is meeting and will greatly assist in the planning and execution of all events and fundraising. Over 350 volunteers are now assisting the 400th staff, and over 100 local and regional businesses are supporting the effort. International interest is growing and is surpassing expectations. Private funding efforts are underway to underwrite this important commemoration. Do we have challenges? Of course we do. And we are going to address many of them at this town meeting. But with all of our recent successes, we also have a great future. Through the actions of town meeting, the hard work of our elected and appointed boards, volunteers, and staff, we continue to grow and thrive as a community. Each time in our local history, when we are faced with challenges, we collectively rise and find solutions. We need to cultivate that and always remember we are one community working together. We have diversified our economy through the growth of our industrial parks, the welcoming of the growth of industrial parks, the welcoming of new businesses through tourism, and through the ever-increasing inclusion of higher education. All of this has made Plymouth not only resilient, but the fastest-growing community in the Commonwealth. People want to come here, whether to live or to open a business, because they understand all the natural beauty and quality of life that we continue to offer them. We may not always agree on the same path or what solution is best, but I do know that we all have the best intentions of our community at heart, and I encourage all of us to remember that in our deliberations today. I want to close with some very wise words of the first leader of this community, Governor William Bradford. Governor Bradford, close to 400 years ago, said these words, and they are as pertinent today as they were back then, when that was a small colony that was taking foot in the New World. All great and honorable actions are accompanied with great difficulties, and both must be enterprised and overcome with answerable courage. Thank you. We wish you well today, and may God continue to bless this great town of ours.
Thank you. That was Kenneth Tavares, Chair of the Plymouth Board of Selectmen. At this time, we'd like to invite Dennis Bagley to come forward. He is Chair of the Plymouth School Committee, and he will be providing the annual State of the Schools address. This is Plymouth Town Meeting. It's coming to you live on PAC TV. We are in the Plymouth North High School. Welcome, Mr. Bagley.
Thank you. Good morning. The past school year has seen our more than 1,100 employees work hard to deliver significant improvements in our curriculum, extracurricular activities, and facilities management to benefit our entire student body. I'd like to take a few minutes to highlight some of our major accomplishments and concerns by reviewing them against the goals established for our strategic plan. As you can remember from prior years, the strategic plan centers around four major goals which serve to guide the district. Goal one is to enhance student social and emotional growth, health and welfare, and demonstration of civic responsibility. The school committee continues to proactively review all of its policies to ensure that they remain current and address ongoing issues with food, safety, and funding, among others. The town's safety committee, made up of representatives from the school district, police, fire, emergency operations, and others, continue to work hard to conduct successful lockdown drills at all of our schools throughout the year and to address all of our general safety needs. All of our students participate in community service efforts across the town, from collecting food and clothing for those less fortunate than themselves to recycling and community beautification efforts. And all of our schools work together to encourage widespread community service among our students. Goal two is to increase family and community engagement. Good communication with families and students is an integral component of any successful school district. In Plymouth, we have added Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Google+, Vimeo to our already robust website and robocall capabilities. So if you're out there, we can reach you. We now get over 30,000 video plays on our EdTV facilities, and we provide easy access to recordings of all of our school committee meetings going back to 2011. It's all been digitized. And the Plymouth Voyager publication continues to grow in readership by offering high-quality articles in a very informative and stylistic manner. Goal three is to enhance academic achievement of all our students at all levels. Our consolidated pre-K program, known as the Plymouth Early Childhood Center and located at PCIS, has been extremely successful this year, as well as our full-day kindergarten program. Our visual and performing arts program continues to grow and amaze with performances like the sold-out Lamez a few weeks ago. Wish I could pronounce it right, but we know what it was. Our curriculum is kept fresh by adding new science and math offerings, encouraging cultural exchanges through language immersion trips, and through continuously improving special education services, to name just a few. If you go to the Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education website, you find that we are graded as a level 2 school district, performing well above the state averages in most areas of measure. And while you're on their website, you'll see that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is in the process of upgrading MCAS to better measure the critical thinking skills students need for success in the 21st century. The next generation MCAS will build upon the MCAS assessments and will include innovative items developed by Park, along with new items specifically created to assess the Massachusetts learning standards. Next generation MCAS is being designed to be taken on a computer, and the plan is to phase in computer-based testing so that computer-based tests are fully administered statewide by 2019. This state requirement will put a significant strain on our existing technology footprint in the next few years and will need to be further addressed in the years to come. Goal number 4 provides strong district and school leadership. We continue to lead the state and the nation in our pursuit for alternative forms of energy. Our solar farms and the solar system on top of Plymouth North High School currently provide all of our electrical needs district-wide. But we will soon take our efforts to the next level by putting solar on the roof and over the parking lots of the new Plymouth South High School. This effort will allow us to provide electricity behind the meter during periods of peak demand throughout the day, while also storing energy in batteries for use at night, energy that will be needed to power the nightlights on our new ball fields. And like with the solar farms, the vendor will cover all equipment costs and pay for the lighting units. Later this morning, we will talk about Article 13 of the special town meeting and what is required to complete the field, so I'll save any additional comments for then. But I would like to close by thanking our staff, the building committee, Ted Gentry Associates, especially Tom Finnegan, for all of their hard work on the high school projects. It's been a long 11-year struggle, but we are almost at the finish line, and the community can take great pride in knowing that they have built model schools that are designed to not only change with the times, but to withstand the test of time. Thank you.
That was Dennis Bagley, chair of the Plymouth School Committee. At this time, we'd like to invite Timothy Grandy to come forward and speak as chair of the Plymouth Planning Board to deliver the State of Plymouth Planning. Welcome, Timothy Grandy.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, Town Meeting members. First, I'd like to say thank you to the planning staff, the other members of the planning board who served with me throughout the last year and moving into the future. I also would like to say thank you to all the committees that give us advisory reports through the steering committees throughout the town of Plymouth. We find them very informative and very helpful through the process with the planning board. Now I'm going to try to make this as quick as possible so you can move on to the business at hand that you have here today, which is very important. We have, with the planning department and staff, it is our job through environmental protection, community housing, economic development, which are the cornerstones of development of planning and development. The mission of the planning board and the staff is to enhance the town's living, working, and natural communities by balancing private property rights with the protection of the town's historic and natural resources. The department will strive and the planning board will strive to develop long and short-term plans that will balance growth and preservation as well as to enable Plymouth to grow smarter in the fifth century moving forward. So now I'd like to hit a couple of bullet points. We created 4 new subdivisions which were approved, creating 18 new residential lots, preserving approximately 36 acres of open space. We also created 30 plans were created, creating 16 new lots. We also went through quite a few article zoning amendments, which I will not go through, which would take too long here today. Staff and the planning board continue to work with town council on comprehensive overhaul of the 40-year-old zoning bylaw. We also continue to work with the North Plymouth Steering Committee and other departments on the new Court Street pedestrian park entrance to the Veterans Field. The town has received Federal Emergency Management Agency FEMA Community Rating System certification, which provides a 5% reduction in flood insurance for the Plymouth property owners. The board and the department planning staff received support from the Board of Selectmen for a dog park location at West Plymouth Recreation Area and continues to work with the Friends of the Plymouth Dog Park on the approval and the construction process. We also created a public art initiative and pilot project to provide creative functional street furniture installed in the downtown waterfront area, continuing to work with the community and Plymouth Bay Cultural District on further initiatives. Now I'll go to the Pine Hills. The Pine Hills continues to grow with the opening and expansion of neighborhoods and new businesses on the Village Green and elsewhere in the Pine Hills. New home sales in the Pine Hills in 2016 remained strong with a total of 100 new homes sold, adding an estimated $58 million in assessed property value for the town of Plymouth. The total attributable to residential property alone, the resulting in net annual property tax revenue to the town of Plymouth of nearly $18 million. The Pine Hills Affordable Housing Charitable Trust, which is in place, had preliminary discussions with the Habitat for Humanity to assist them in funding for three home projects they are planning for a site off Long Pond Road. Habitat was successful in December in getting planning board approval for the plan and anticipates filing a formal funding request with the trust in early 2017. In January of 2016, the Pine Hills was named Community of the Year in the Best in American Living Awards by the National Association of Home Builders. It's quite an accomplishment. Now I'd like to move on to Red Brook down in South Plymouth off of Bourne Road. Red Brook and AD Makepeace Company continues to set the tone for South Plymouth. This new village setting is pure Plymouth with cranberry bogs, towering trees, and open skies. In accordance with the site plan approved by the planning board, approximately one quarter of the 1,800 site will be developed in a village consisting of 1,175 homes. The remainder will be preserved in its natural state at build-out, which will occur over a decade. In October, Red Brook received a total of 5 gold and silver honors from the prestigious Prism Awards. The AD Makepeace Company completed construction of a multi-purpose playing field behind the South Elementary School. It's all gated in right now. We'll probably use it in the spring, which is fantastic for the young people down in South Plymouth. You have a brand new baseball field and a recreational field down there. In addition, the company through the Makepeace Neighborhood Fund made 3 grants totaling $21,950 to Plymouth Public Schools projects, plus another $52,150 in grants to provide nonprofit organizations that benefit the Plymouth residents. With that, the board looks forward to continue to work with planning staff, the Board of Selectmen, and the town meeting members going forward through the next year to come. Good luck with your deliberations today. God bless you, and God bless our great town. Thank you.
That was Timothy Grandy. He is the chair of the Plymouth Planning Board. We now welcome Mark Rich of Coltman and Page, and he'll be serving as town council throughout today's session of town meeting. Welcome. And at this time, we welcome John Moody, who is chair of the Advisory and Finance Committee, who will now deliver his opening remarks. Mr. Moody.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Is this working? Now it's working. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Good morning to you all, state and town officials, department heads, town meeting members, and the general public who has joined us here in the auditorium, and those who are watching us on PAC TV. Today is the fifth time I have appeared before you as a spokesperson for the Advisory and Finance Committee, and it is sometimes hard to believe that I have served as the acting chairman or chairman of this committee for the past 5 years, much longer than I had originally planned. As town meeting approached, I contemplated the work that the committee has done over that time. This morning, I'd like to spend a few moments talking about the Advisory and Finance Committee and its role in our town meeting form of government. One of the reasons I have chosen to speak about the role of the committee are comments at the past two town meetings that the Finance Committee says yes to everything. That, in effect, the committee is a rubber stamp for town management. In my interaction with town meeting members, I find that view to be an absolute minority one, and that generally the committee is well regarded. However, that criticism has caused me to consider the role of the committee and how well or poorly we may be fulfilling that role. So I thought I would share my comments with you this morning. Since joining the committee in January 2006, it has been my fundamental belief that one of the chief roles of the committee is to protect the taxpayer from runaway spendthrift government through critical examination of the annual budget proposal and other spending initiatives of the town, making the appropriate recommendations to you, town meeting. And I ask myself why the committee doesn't say no more often than it does. The role of the committee is much more complex than just weighing in on the town's spending proposals. It reaches far beyond simply saying no to spending, as seems to have become popular in some political circles today. Determining whether an expenditure makes sense requires an understanding and an appreciation for the expenditure's purpose and what it means if that expenditure is not made. For example, we all understand that saving money by not performing necessary building maintenance is more costly in the long run, and while providing a short-term benefit to one's wallet, is absolutely not in the best interests of the building owner, you, the taxpayer. That is the balancing act the committee concerns itself with virtually every issue that comes before it, whether it involves the actual expenditure of money or not. What value does a proposal bring to individual residents of the town or to the community as a whole? And are the resources, whether that is money, time, employees, materials, or some other resource, expended in line with the value produced? In pursuing the assessment of each proposal, the committee and its members, according to most town meeting members, town officials and department heads I have discussed this topic with, perhaps delve deeper, much deeper, publicly at least, into most proposals than any other person other than that the person making the proposal. Herein is an important role of the committee. We perform a fact-finding mission, culling out the information needed to make informed decisions and sharing that information with you, town meeting, so that each of you individually do not have to do so in order to render an informed decision. As such, we serve as a conduit of information and a facilitator of town meeting's decision-making process. Through questioning of article proponents and additional research conducted by individual members, the committee extracts the information necessary for it to make informed recommendations to town meeting. Could we do a better job? In some cases, absolutely. Do we sometimes miss an important point or nuance about an issue? Yes. Everything and all of us can always be improved. To that end, over the past 4.5 years, in addition to its mandated work of reviewing the annual budget proposal of the town manager and board of selectmen, and each of the articles that are presented to town meeting for a vote, the committee has worked diligently to improve itself and how it conducts business so as to bring greater value to the community's deliberative processes. Just to touch on a few of these changes, the advisory and finance committee has established closer ties with town meeting through regular participation at the committee of precinct chairs and tighter coordination in scheduling FinCom resources to attend caucuses. Expedited and strengthened the flow of information through the committee to town meeting by posting our meeting packets on the town website before our meetings and posting article background information as we receive it. We post the report and recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee to the town website before you receive it in the mail, which is delivered to the best of our ability 21 days in advance of town meeting rather than the statutory 14 days. Revised our annual budget hearing process and format to address key findings and recommendations of the budget subcommittees in a presentation style format rather than a reading of the lengthy and, to be honest, quite often boring budget reports. Established a separate budget subcommittee for enterprise funds to better focus on the unique matters that arise in enterprise fund budgeting. And we have explored new areas of opportunity and lobbied for improvements within Town Hall to address specific financial concerns, such as the growing OPEB liability and work currently in process around revenue sources and budgeting. In my personal assessment, I believe the Advisory and Finance Committee is fulfilling its role. And while it may appear to the casual observer that we say yes to everything, those who are watching carefully recognize how thoroughly the committee vets each and every issue placed before it. With that said, I would like to present the members of the Advisory and Finance Committee. First, Kevin Canty, who is the second vice chairman. Please stand when I call your name. Next is Betty Cavaco. And just so you can prepare yourselves, I put these in alphabetical order by last name. Robert Cody. Judith Fitzgerald, who is not with us today. Harry Helm. Ethan Kuzman. Mike Lincoln. Peter Mador. Christopher Merrill. Chris has served the committee for 12 years. And he has advised me that he will not be renewing his commitment to the committee for personal reasons. So we thank you very much for your service, Chris. Patrick O'Brien, who is not with us today. Harry Salerno, first vice chairman. Sheila Sheridan. Mark Sirico. And Scott Stevenson. Now, a list of the committee's membership would not be complete if I did not mention Carrie Gillette. Sorry, get a grip, John. While Carrie is not an actual member of the committee, she does perform much of the coordinative and administrative work necessary for the committee to do its work and for town meeting to convene. Not to mention that she has been an essential resource in implementing many of the changes I discussed earlier. She is a valued member of the team, and I hope she knows how much she is appreciated by me personally, members of the committee, and I believe by all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Moody. John Moody, Chair of the Advisory and Finance Committee. We are all reminded that our Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 71, Section 37, prohibit the use of any tobacco products within the school buildings, the school facilities, or the school grounds. Edward Fine is the police officer on duty for this session of town meeting. There are written materials available at the sign-in table. This morning, you received from the Town Advisory and Finance Committee a Supplement 1 to the report and recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. Since that time, there are a couple of other changes related to this document, and we will alert you as we proceed through town meeting. We also have the book for the spring town meeting, the special town meeting. It's a light blue. We have the reports and recommendations for the annual town meeting. Also, you should have the general government proposed operating budget. And then there is a 2018 budget book for the Plymouth Schools. The Community Preservation Committee has provided a book related to the special annual town meeting, and also they provided the Town of Plymouth Community Preservation Act book. And if you do not have these, you could check at the table of the head teller. Now, our town charter and the town bylaws govern the manner in which we operate in the Town of Plymouth. And these are available on the website, along with the town meeting handbook that was previously adopted, and we also follow rules governing town meeting debate. Town Charter, Chapter 2, Section 5, Subsection 2, provides that the town clerk keeps the record of attendance at town meeting, and any representative town meeting member who cannot attend a session shall provide written notice to the town clerk. It is the town clerk who prepares the roll call list in advance to town meeting based on the written notice received from town meeting members. Any town meeting member who is given notice as to absence will not be included in the roll. Anyone wishing to inquire as to reasons given for town meeting absence should check with the town clerk. And also, our town charter provides that town meeting members shall notify the town clerk in writing in advance prior to a town meeting session as to any articles giving rise to a financial conflict of interest. I'd like to remind you that any Plymouth resident and taxpayer may speak on a matter. Prior to this session, I was asked about whether or not there are some non-residents present who may wish to address town meeting, and I would ask any non-resident to please identify yourself as a non-resident in order that we may determine whether town meeting wishes to provide consent. In addition to those present in the room, we do have a live cable audience, so we request that if you wish to speak and you raise your hand, and once you've been recognized, use one of the microphones that have been provided and identify yourself. The town meeting members and town officials are encouraged to identify yourselves by name and precinct or title each time you speak. Since some of the members of our cable audience will tune in from time to time, the members of the Board of Selectmen are seated in the front row, and you've seen the members of the Advisory and Finance Committee are seated also in the front row. We request that those who wish to present an article to come down front at the beginning of the reading of the article and sit in the front rows in their space to my left. In addition, if you anticipate you might be answering questions on articles, we ask that you move close to a microphone at the start of the article. And if you're called as a speaker on deck, if you could move to the microphone once your name has been announced. Now, town meeting members are reminded that a vote may be questioned if 7 town meeting members rise to question the vote. And you do not need to be formally recognized in order to question. Just stand up and you'll be counted. Because there may be a standing vote, and we ask that all members remain standing until seated by your teller. There are tellers available throughout the meeting. If you have special needs or if you have a concern for which you do not wish to interrupt the meeting with a point of order, you could speak to a teller who could communicate to me through the clerk. Today, our tellers are Roxanne Whitbeck, Jennifer Harris, Thomas Marr, and Pamela Bagardi. We also have Timothy Lathwood from Option Technologies, who is here today. And at this time, Brian Alosi, Assistant Town Moderator, will make a few comments regarding the electronic voting. Mr. Alosi.
Yes, first of all, if you haven't done so, please turn off your phone, mute any electronic device that you have so that we don't have anything going off. With your clicker, just a couple of 101 comments that one is yes, press two for no, and three is abstain. The bottom right button right here is your power button. And I've been told by Tim from Option Technologies, who is in the blue shirt over here, that if you have any problems with your clicker, to see him. I'll be going back and forth after votes and whatnot, so hopefully to catch any discrepancies that there might be. But for the most part, it's on your, it's for you to notify Tim if there's any discrepancy. As far as being able to leave the room with the clicker, you can do that. Evidently, years been in the past, we haven't been able to do that because there's been some problems. But you can leave the room and leave the leave it on. However, at noontime, you may want to close it, may want to shut it off with that power button to conserve your battery power. But other than that, if you have any discrepancies or issues, see Tim.
Thank you, Mr. Alosi. And town meeting debate will be directed through me. All main motions, amendments to main motions, are to be in writing, and all procedural motions, whenever practicable, are to be submitted in advance. We do have a rule that we generally follow that we've passed in the past that motions should be submitted to the moderator by noon on the day prior to a town meeting and the day before an evening meeting. And many town meeting members were in contact with me for the past several weeks. There was at least one member who provided me with the motion this morning, since apparently I didn't receive it through email, it may have been quarantined. So it works very well if you can send me proposed motions by email or by fax. And if I don't respond to you within 24 hours, I would just ask that you call me to make sure that I get it. If you wish to accomplish something procedurally during the course of the meeting, please don't hesitate to get up to inquire. We'll attempt to help you frame an appropriate motion that's consistent with either past practice or our parliamentary handbook, which is town meeting time. There are copies of this at the library. Now, in town meeting time, there's a provision on page 25 that says, even if all of the rest of the meeting knows the answer, it does no harm to review and restate a principle from time to time. So I'm gonna do that today, and the reason is that prior to town meeting, there was a town meeting member who came to me and said that he wanted to make a motion to suspend the rules in order to provide town meeting members standing at the queue to be heard regardless of when they were recognized by me. I told him that I would not entertain that motion, and I will read to you the appropriate language from town meeting time, which is found on page 24, number 2, powers and duties of the moderator. No person addresses the meeting without leave of the moderator. So for that town meeting member, and he said he spoke on behalf of others, for the others on behalf that he spoke, I just want to explain that the moderator will be recognizing the order in which people speak. If there's an amendment presented from the floor and it contains a legal question or has legal ramifications, I may confer with town council to have it researched or written before we move forward. And the tellers do have pens and pencil cards available to reduce your motions to writing. Debate is encouraged. If I'm notified in advance you wish to speak in an article, your name will be added to a list of scheduled speakers. A number of people have contacted me, both town meeting members and non-town meeting members. Attempt to give everyone a chance to speak before calling on people a second time. And there is at least one formal petitioner presentation, which can be up to 15 minutes. However, all of the speakers will be limited to 5 minutes, and that includes question and answer exchanges. And you are all reminded that while the moderator limits the scope of the debate, you limit the length of the debate. If you wish to close debate, you may move the previous question. That motion is not debatable, and it requires a two-thirds vote. Now, throughout town meeting, the assistant moderator and I will be presiding, and we do not intend to become directly involved in the discussion. We will be procedural facilitators to this legislative body. On some of the substantive motions, we may receive a motion to fix the method of voting by roll call vote. And our town charter also requires roll call vote in a number of cases when it is not unanimous. The motion to fix the method of voting is a majority vote. Standing votes will not be required for motions requiring a two-thirds vote unless I am in doubt. Also, a motion to change the order of the articles requires a two-thirds vote. I have at least one motion to change the order of the articles. And also, a town meeting member who votes on the prevailing side of a motion may later move to reconsider the motion. We will recess within 2 hours from the start of this meeting, as provided in our charter. And a reminder that a quorum is presumed, and we will reconvene 15 minutes following a recess other than the noon recess. Refreshments are served in the cafeteria at approximately 12 noon, and we will return promptly and begin after the recess. The return of the warrant of the annual town meeting shows it has properly been served. If there are no objections, we will waive the reading of the constable's return of service of the warrant of the annual town meeting, and further, if there are no objections, we will waive the reading of the warrant. Mr. Moody moves that the adjourned sessions of the annual town meeting be held on the following dates and times at Plymouth North High School. And that would be Monday, April 3rd at 7, Tuesday, April 4th at 7, and Wednesday, April 5th at 7. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Motion, I believe, carries unanimously. And I also want to ask that town meeting members sit in the two sections in the center and to the right so that there's no question on the voting. Normally, I will take a voice vote first and then possibly retake it or do electronic voting if there's in doubt. Now, historically, we recess for 1 hour at lunch. However, I have another procedural motion. Mr. Babini moves that the lunch recess be reduced from 1 hour to 45 minutes. Mr. Babini, do you care to be heard on your motion to reduce the lunch recess from 1 hour to 45 minutes? This is the Plymouth Town Meeting, Mr. Babini.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Yes, we did it last town meeting. I think it worked well. We have a lot of business, and I think 45 minutes is certainly adequate for us to have lunch and take a break. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, I usually have at least one practice vote with the electronic voting, and that'll be this one. So if you can get your clickers ready, and we'll be taking a vote on whether or not to reduce the lunch recess. And as soon as the light goes on, you can begin to vote. The light is on. You'll see that when the light is on, we have time running in terms of how long you can vote, and this procedural motion is continuing to count down. And we also see how many people are voting, 120 out of 136, 121 out of 136. And next it passes, 94 in favor, 24 in opposition, 4 people abstained. And now you'll see, as we go through the list of precincts, as to whether or not your vote was tabulated as you intended to vote. So if for any reason your vote is not shown or it did not appear as you voted, please check with Options Technology. And you'll see we've gone through all the precincts. And at this time, we have another procedural motion. Mr. Costello, Precinct 10, moves to change the order of the articles to hear Article 16E before Article 16A. It requires a two-thirds vote. It is debatable. Mr. Costello, do you care to be heard on your motion to change the order? This is Plymouth Town Meeting coming to you live from Plymouth North High School. Mr. Costello.
Good morning. Alan Costello, Precinct 10. Yes, I've put this motion forward to move 16E ahead of all of the CPC articles. And the rationale there is that it's a spending article, and I think the information about it is a little dire. It puts us in a bad financial state with the committee, so I think before we spend any money on previous articles, we should hear that first. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion on the motion to change the order of the articles 16E before 16A? If there's no more discussion, I will first call for a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
No.
The motion carries by more than two-thirds. So unless seven members question the vote, we will proceed with that. And at this time, Mr. Moody moves that the Plymouth annual spring town meeting be recessed until the Plymouth special town meeting is adjourned or dissolved. Any discussion? Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries. The annual town meeting is recessed at this time at 9:06 a.m. The return of the warrant of the special town meeting shows it has properly been served. If there are no objections, we'll waive the reading of the constable's return of service of the warrant of the special town meeting, and further, if there are no objections, we'll waive the reading of the warrant. And at this time, we will now proceed to the special town meeting. And you'll see that you have a number of motions before you in addition to the article. First, Article 1, to see if the town will vote to amend the classification and compensation plans and the personnel bylaw and collective bargaining agreements contained therein, or take any other action relative thereto. Mr. Moody moves that the town vote to amend the personnel bylaw in accordance with a memorandum dated February 1, 2017, from Marie Brinkman, Director of Human Resources, located on pages 27 and 28 to 28, labeled A, and amend the Cobra Crossing Guard Meter Enforcement Officer Collective Bargaining Agreement by adding a senior step for meter enforcement officers per the memorandum dated February 3, 2017 from Derek Brindisi, Assistant Town Manager, located on page 31, labeled C, and memorandum dated January 19, 2017 from Melissa Arrighi, Town Manager, located on pages 32, 30 to 33, labeled D, all found in the special town meeting report and recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee divided the article into four separate components, discussing and voting each individually. The first motion addresses the three of the four components. The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve the changes to the personnel bylaw proposed in the memo from Marie Brinkman, Director of Human Resources, which shall be known as Component A. The amendment to the Cobra Crossing Guard Meter Enforcement Officer Collective Bargaining Agreement, Component C, and the changes to the personnel bylaw proposed in the memo from Melissa Arrighi, Town Manager, Component D. Component A involves housekeeping changes and updates to incorporate current practices into the personnel bylaw. The town's personnel bylaw governs all non-union employees. Component C adds a senior step to the meter enforcement officer's salary table. This would be a 2% increase once the employee is maxed out at step 5 and completes 10 years of service. There is one meter enforcement officer remaining who works directly for the town. Total compensation for the proposed changes in fiscal year 2018 is estimated at $645. Component D adds two new sections to the personnel bylaw. One adds language derived from what is commonly known as the Strong Chief Statutes of Massachusetts General Laws. Whether town meeting votes to rescind the town's acceptance of the Strong Chief Statutes in special town meeting articles 9 and 10 or not, adding this language to the personnel bylaw is still appropriate in terms of clarifying the roles and responsibilities of the police chief and fire chief and establishing authority for each chief to make rules and regulations for each department. The second addition inserts language relating to the disciplinary measures that would apply to all non-union employees. It includes language regarding removal of an employee for just cause and the rights of the employee during and after the disciplinary proceedings. Currently, there is no language in the personnel bylaw that addresses discipline. The new section mimics the existing discipline language, which is in the OPEIU contract.
Thank you. And just to draw to your attention, in addition to the supplementary book from the Advisory and Finance Committee, we also have motions presented to the special town meeting, as well as motions for the annual town meeting. And so I wish to draw to your attention the motions that we have for today's special town meeting. Mr. Weber, Precinct 3, moves to amend the main motion from the Advisory and Finance Committee by dividing into three separate motions, A, C, and D. A motion to divide is a majority vote. Mr. Weber.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dale Weber, Precinct 3. As was done at the Finance Committee, I think that some of the components of this Article 1 should be divided and taken up separately so that each stands on its own merits. Thank you.
Any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote on the motion to divide. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries. We will now divide Article 1 into three motions, beginning with Motion 1A. Mr. Moody moves the town vote to amend the personnel bylaw in accordance with a memorandum dated February 1, 2017 from Marie Brinkman, Director of Human Resources, located on pages 27 to 28, labeled A, of the special town meeting report and recommendation of the Advisory and Finance Committee. It's a majority vote. Discussion.
I believe I've already covered our recommendation. The reason that the Advisory and Finance Committee combined these three components into one motion was because our quantum of vote, or the votes that we received for each of those items, was exactly the same. So we felt that the view of the committee was the same on all three of those elements.
Further discussion on Motion 1A. Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries by a majority. Now, Motion 1C, Mr. Moody moves the town vote to amend the Cobra Crossing Guard Meter Enforcement Officer Collective Bargaining Agreement by adding a senior step for meter enforcement officers per the memorandum dated February 3, 2017 from Derek Brindisi, Assistant Town Manager, located on page 31, labeled C, of the Special Town Meeting Report and Recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. It's a majority vote.
I have no additional comments other than those that have already been provided.
Further discussion on Motion 1C. Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries unanimously. Motion 1D, Mr. Moody moves the town vote to amend the personnel bylaw in accordance with a memorandum dated January 19, 2017 from Melissa Riggi, town manager, located on pages 32 to 33, labeled D, of the special town meeting report and recommendation of the Advisory and Finance Committee. It's a majority vote. Mr. Moody.
I have no additional comments.
Any further discussion on Motion 1D? If not, I will call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. The motion carries by more than a majority. At this time, we will continue under Article 1 for Motion 2. And this motion was revised this morning. Again, a reminder to town meeting members that the Board of Selectmen, the Advisory and Finance Committee, the Plymouth School Committee, and the Planning Board do post meetings at the start of each session of town meeting. And it is possible for you to attend them. Advisory and Finance Committee did have a vote this morning, and that vote resulted in no motion from the Advisory and Finance Committee. Instead, Mr. Tavares moves that the town vote to amend the personnel bylaw in accordance with the memorandum dated March 29, 2017 from Derek Brindisi, Assistant Town Manager, located on pages 5 to 6, label B in the supplement 1 to the report and recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. It's a majority vote. Mr. Tavares On behalf of Mr. Tavares, we will hear from Derek Brindisi, Assistant Town Manager. Welcome, Mr. Brindisi, on the motion by the Board of Selectmen.
Great, thank you, and good morning. Derek Brindisi, Assistant Town Manager. So just by way of background, there are a number of medical stipends, specialty training stipends, and other stipends that the men and women of our public safety department carry with them as they rise to the ranks and receive these types of qualifications. So it's our opinion that as you rise to these ranks, we don't want to take away these financial stipends, because there's an expectation that all of our men and women maintain these types of qualifications as they move through the ranks, for example, when you go from a police officer to a captain. So therefore, it made a lot of sense, given the fact that a new qualification is to be certified in Narcan, for example, given the opioid epidemic that we're all facing. So for those reasons alone, we ask you to support this article. Thank you.
Thank you. There is no motion to amend, to split the motion, since the licensure motion has been withdrawn. Any further discussion on the motion number two?
Yes, Mr. Moderator.
Advisory and Finance Committee, John Moody.
I'd just like to speak to the process that the Finance Committee went through this morning and the decision that it came to. At the request of Town Management, the Advisory and Finance Committee reconsidered, if you will, although not in a formal parliamentary sense, its approval of Special Town Meeting Article 1, Memo B. The process through which we did that was because Town Management had stricken the part of the memo related to licensure, the committee rescinded its previous approval of Memo B, which was a 7-5-0 vote, in order to pave the way for a new motion that would, approve Article 1, Memo B, as amended by Town Management. Once the original approval was rescinded, the committee voted 5-7-0 not to support the stipends portion of Memo 1, of Memo B of Special Town Meeting Article 1. The rationale used by some of the members in casting their vote revolved around a sense that this was probably not the correct way to fix a problem that is an ongoing problem. And so members of the committee commented that we should fix the problem with the salary adjustments that we expect to come out of the current study, which is in progress, of the townwide salary study. And we should fix the problem through that rather than through a series of stipends. Another member commented that this is a Rube Goldberg solution of patches, providing stipends for various accreditations that police or firefighters receive, when in fact that should really be part of the salary schema that is used for compensating those employees.
It's a majority vote for the discussion. Yes, please come forward, Dale Weber.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dale Weber, Precinct 3. I just want to rise to address what my vote will be on this, and not to encourage anyone one way or the other. I won't be supporting this, only because if I was to put on my other hat today as an employee representative, I would state for the record that when employee representatives go into the collective bargaining process and negotiate for certain stipends, certain licenses, and certain benefits, oftentimes those benefits are gained through concessions and giving up existing benefits or existing gains in the past. So what we're faced with here now, and again, I'm only supporting my upcoming no vote, is the fact that these benefits that were hard-fought concessions by the organized employee groups in Plymouth are now being handed to the non-organized employee groups in Plymouth. And I think there's a moral issue here. And that hopefully that explained my no vote. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, please come forward. We're debating motion number 2 under Article 1 of Plymouth Special Town Meeting. Gerald Sirico, Precinct 3.
Excuse me, Mr. Moderator, it's Jerry. These stipends, I'd like answered. This is just for the management people, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, now, what?
If we're going to have questions, have them come to me, and then we'll call on someone to answer.
All right, these are for the non-union people.
Mr. Brindisi, do you care to respond? Please come to the microphone.
That is correct. Again, these stipends are currently enjoyed by unit members and then would be, then if agreed upon, would be given to non-union members, yes.
Any stipend that they're going to receive, is it something that they'll be performing during their...
Well, mentioned earlier, the expectation is that by management that there's an expectation that they maintain these qualifications. We do believe that if they're going to maintain these qualifications, like administering Narcan and AEDs and things of that nature, that they should then receive the associated stipend.
But generally, they won't be performing this as a general job duty.
In their general duties, again, I would consider them all first responders, and if they had to respond, that they need to be qualified in doing so. And again, we do know in cases that they have administered Narcan.
Well, I'd like to say that I won't be supporting this either.
Further discussion on motion number 2 under Article 1 of the special town meeting. Hearing none, we'll call for a vote. It is a majority vote. We'll still first do a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Both say no.
No.
Motion does not carry. And at this time, absent any further motions under Article 1 of the special town meeting, we'll move to Article 2 and we'll move to the motion. Mr. Moody moves the town vote to transfer $70,000 from the fiscal year 2017 budget for member benefits to the fiscal year 2017 budget for town manager department other expenses. This is a majority vote and it is a roll call if it is not unanimous. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 2. Town meeting approval of this article will transfer $70,000 from the fiscal year 2017 budget for member benefits, workers' compensation, to cover an anticipated shortfall in the fiscal year 2017 town manager department other expenses, specifically for legal service costs associated with representing the town in the sewer litigation.
Further discussion? Board of Selectmen are in support. Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries unanimously. Article 3, I have no motion. Hearing no motion, I declare no action. Article 4, Mr. Moody moves the town vote to appropriate the sum of $2,200,000 to pay costs of the Taylor Avenue Water Main Project and for the payment of all costs incidental or related thereto. And you have the text of the motion in your packet of materials. It's a two-thirds vote. A roll call if it is not unanimous. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 4. Approval of this article will fund the design, permitting, engineering, and construction of the water main on Taylor Avenue. This work will be done prior to the full road reconstruction project scheduled this fall. The current water main is very old, and there is concern about its ability to hold up during road construction and sustain the area's water supply into the future. The proposed work will replace the 8-inch cast iron main with a 12-inch ductile iron main, including new services, hydrants, and gate valves from the White Horse Road to Manomet Point Road.
Board of Selectmen are in support. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll call for a vote. We have Mr. Babini, Michael Babini, town meeting member. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I just want to confirm that this money is being taken out of the water enterprise zone. Is that correct? The town water enterprise zone?
The question is as to the source of the funding. Can anyone care to respond? Melissa Arrighi, town manager. Good morning.
Good morning. Yes, that is correct. The water enterprise fund.
Thank you.
Further discussion on Article 4. Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries unanimously. We now move to Article 5, and Mr. Moody moves the town votes to supplement each prior vote of the town that authorizes the borrowing of money to pay costs of capital projects to provide that in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, the premium received by the town upon the sale of any bonds or notes thereunder, less any such premium applied to the payment of costs of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to pay project costs, and the amount authorized to be borrowed for each such project shall be reduced by the amount of any such premium so applied. It's a majority vote. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 5. The Municipal Modernization Act, effective November 7th, 2016, changed the treatment of bond proceeds with respect to premiums received on bonds. Town meeting approval of this article will allow the town to follow the amended statute on all previous authorizations where the long-term borrowing has not been finalized, so that any premiums received will be used to reduce the borrowing and pay for the project costs. This effectively grandfathers the Municipal Modernization Act changes for all projects voted prior to November 2016.
Board of Selectmen in support. It's a majority vote. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries. Article 6, Mr. Moody moves the town vote to authorize to transfer from free cash the sum of $1 million to the Nuclear Plant Mitigation Stabilization Fund, as authorized by the provisions of General Laws Chapter 40, Section 5B, which fund shall be under the care and custody of the town treasurer. It's a majority vote. It is a roll call if it is not unanimous. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 6. Approval of this article will authorize the town to transfer $1 million from free cash to the Nuclear Plant Mitigation Stabilization Fund. Funds are being set aside for future use as it relates to the energy nuclear power plant and the effect that its closure will have on the town's budget, tax rate, and economic development. The current balance of the Nuclear Plant Mitigation Stabilization Fund is $3,739,246. As with all stabilization funds, a two-thirds vote of town meeting would be required for withdrawals from the stabilization fund.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Carries unanimously. Article 7, Mr. Moody moves the town vote to establish a pavement management plan debt stabilization fund. And this, you have the text. It's a two-thirds vote and a roll call if it is not unanimous. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 7. Approval of this article will create a pavement management program debt stabilization fund and transfer $1,019,741 from free cash into the stabilization fund. This is the amount of the excess 2016 motor vehicle excise taxes, or the amount that was brought in over what was originally budgeted by the finance director. The state requires that excess excise tax flow to free cash. Moving forward, this stabilization fund can be funded annually in the same manner, with town meeting voting to transfer the excess motor vehicle excise taxes, which flowed to free cash the previous year, into the stabilization fund. The Pavement Management Program Debt Stabilization Fund will be used to pay the debt service on any borrowing associated with the ongoing maintenance, repair, and construction of roads reducing the need for property tax increases for that purpose.
Board of Selectmen are in support. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries unanimously. We now move to Article 8, where Mr. Moody moves the town vote to amend the general bylaws by inserting a bylaw, Chapter 143, Departmental Revolving Funds, as found on pages 9 to 12 of Supplement 1 to the Special and Annual Town Meeting Report and Recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. It's a majority vote. A roll call if it's not unanimous. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee unanimously recommends town meeting approve Article 8. I will also just point out that the Advisory and Finance Committee in its meeting this morning voted again unanimously to support this article, given the changes that appear in the supplement that was provided to you this morning. There were some changes made in the table, the very last row of the table, was revised at the request of bond counsel. Approval of this article will amend the general bylaws by adding Chapter 143, Departmental Revolving Funds. This bylaw will authorize the town's revolving funds for fiscal year 19 and beyond. General Laws Chapter 44, Section 53E and 1/2 was recently updated by the Municipal Modernization Act, which requires that revolving funds be established by bylaw instead of an annual legislative body vote. Annual spending caps will still be voted at town meeting annually, and the annual town meeting Article 3, which we'll see when we get to the annual town meeting, is taking care of the revolving funds for fiscal year 2018, as this amendment to our general bylaws needs to go through a state approval process.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries unanimously. We now move to Article 9. Mr. Moody moves that the town vote to rescind the vote taken under Article 91 of the 1973 annual town meeting, which accepted the provisions of General Laws Chapter 48, Section 42, commonly known as the Strong Fire Chief Statute. Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee, on a vote of 10-2-0, recommends town meeting approve Article 9. Approval of this article will rescind Plymouth's acceptance of the provisions of General Laws Chapter 48, Section 42, more commonly known as the Strong Fire Chief Statute. A substantial portion of this law is obsolete, so it makes sense to rescind. The town is pulling out the relevant language and adding it to the personnel bylaw in special town meeting Article 1, which we already did.
And the Board of Selectmen are in support. It's a majority vote. Any further discussions? Hearing none, call for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
No.
The motion carries by a majority. Article 10. Do 7 town meeting members question the vote? I see more than 7 questioning the vote, and rather than go to the tellers, we'll go to electronic voting. So we will be voting electronically by roll call on Article 9 because there was a question of the voice vote as to whether I heard a majority voting in favor. And so when the light goes on, you can vote now. See, the seconds are clicking down and the numbers of people are voting. Voting has now been completed, and we see that a majority did vote in favor, 78 voting in favor, 37 in opposition, 4 abstentions. And for those of you who are watching both here in the Center for Performing Arts as well as at home, you will see that precincts are shown on the screen. We're currently at precinct 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Town meeting members also have an opportunity to check to make sure that your vote was recorded properly. And in any case, when it was not, You can rise to a point of order to correct the vote. And at this time, we'll be moving to Article 10. Mr. Moody moves the town vote to rescind the vote taken under Article 82 of the 1971 annual town meeting, which accepted provisions of General Laws Chapter 41, Section 97A, commonly known as the Strong Police Chief Statute. Majority vote, Mr. Moody.
The Advisory and Finance Committee, on a vote of 10-2-0, recommends town meeting approve Article 10. Approval of this article will rescind Plymouth's acceptance of the provisions of General Laws Chapter 41, Section 97A, more commonly known as the Strong Police Chief Statute. A substantial portion of this law is obsolete, so it makes sense to rescind. The town is pulling out the relevant language and adding it to the personnel bylaw.
Board of Selectmen in support, any discussion? Hearing none, I will call for a vote. It is a majority vote. We will first take a voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
No.
It does carry by a majority of votes. We will now move to Article 11. Article 11. Mr. Moody moves that the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to petition the General Court for special legislation, providing that the effective date of such legislation for the position of fire chief and deputy fire chief shall not be subject to the civil service statute as found in the warrant language on page 81 of the special town meeting report and recommendations of the Advisory and Finance Committee. You have the text before you, Mr. Moody.
This is another item of business reviewed by the Advisory and Finance Committee at our meeting this morning. At that meeting, the Advisory and Finance Committee voted 7-5-0 to recommend that town meeting approve Article 11. The basis for the change in our decision was really because committee members felt that the veterans policy that had been put in place by the Board of Selectmen addressed some of the concerns that were raised about this article. Approval of this article would remove the positions of fire chief and deputy fire chief from civil service. Town management, including the fire chief, believe removing these positions from civil service has merit, would improve efficiency, and help with succession planning. By law, Chief Bradley must retire by June 30th, 2020. At the latest, and there are currently no candidates on the civil service list to replace him. Civil service is not offering the chief test this year or next year. Under civil service, if no candidates are on the list, then the town cannot make a permanent hire as fire chief. The town would most likely have to find a retired fire chief with little or no knowledge about Plymouth to come in on a temporary basis until someone from the list is hired permanently, supposing, of course, that such a list gets compiled. If the fire chief and deputy chief positions are removed from civil service, the town would have the same flexibility as it currently has with hiring other departments, with hiring other department heads. Also, with such hires as a means of checks and balances, the Board of Selectmen have the ability to veto the hiring of any selected individual. Union representatives spoke about the history and strengths of civil service, particularly about its separation from political pressure, cronyism, and nepotism. The Advisory and Finance Committee had a lot of questions and discussion about this topic. They saw merit with both sides of the argument, and in the end, voted to change its vote to support Article 11.
Board of Selectmen are in support. Melissa Origi, town manager, speaking on behalf of the board. Welcome.
Thank you very much. This is a difficult subject, and I recognize that just by the audience here as well as each caucus that we went to. And the fire chief and I do not bring this lightly to town meeting or to the selectmen or to the finance committee. This is not a fight between labor and management. The firefighters and management have worked well together, and we've certainly disagreed on issues. You saw in their last contract negotiations, we brought an agreement here to this body. But in this particular matter, as your appointing authority, I would be absolutely remiss in my duties if I didn't look at the situation in the fire department, realize that we could potentially have one vacancy now, and we could easily have another one at the chief level. Without the ability to have that civil service list, which is in many ways our whole succession planning, they provide us with that list of the top scoring people in three different methods that you can go about getting that. Without that list, my ability to appoint you a permanent fire chief in one of your most important departments, a department with an over $11 million budget, well over 100 employees, these are critical positions, and I have to be in the position to be able to fill them. One of the things that's come up over and over, and one of the issues that you can just feel in the air today, is that as your town manager, I am not trying to protect the rank and file. Even worse, I'm trying to hurt them. That is not the case. The rank and file from battalion chief to firefighter is completely covered by civil service rights. I've made a commitment publicly. The fire chief has spoken publicly. The Board of Selectmen have taken a very strong public stand that this article that we're asking you to do today will not lead to the elimination of the civil service protections at the rank and file. But more importantly than just listening to your town manager, your fire chief, the Board of Selectmen, all of those groups can change. The language that you see in italics in front of you is in the firefighters' collective bargaining agreement. That alone protects their civil service rights. In order for us to remove civil service from over 100 men and women in that department, we would have to bargain that at table bargaining. Then it would have to come back before this body. So any implication that I am trying to do something to eliminate all these rights from the men and women in that department is just simply not the case. We also heard that some towns are joining civil service, which is true, and some towns are leaving it, which is what I'm asking you to do with the chief and the deputy chief's position. But we wanted to look at the statistics of that picture. Only 54 chiefs in Massachusetts are still civil service. But that is just a statistic to look at over the 351 cities and towns. More importantly, we wanted to look at, well, what kind of towns don't have their chief in civil service. It wasn't fair to look at the three most populated cities, which I did first, because you can't really compare those to Plymouth. So we moved on to cities and towns with populations between 90,000 people and 50,000 people. Felt that was a fair comparison. Well, it's split down the middle. Half of those chiefs are civil service, and half of those chiefs are not. But I wanted to go a little further than that. We dropped that search down to cities and towns with populations down to 30,000 people. And again, it was split down the middle. Half is civil service, half are not civil service. So I think what this really comes down to is community preference, the decision that you make today. Do we want the chief and deputy chief's positions in civil service, or don't we? Now keep in mind, we wouldn't be here if the civil service was working for us at this level of the organization. If we had a list in front of us right now to appoint from, there would be no reason to be standing here. I know that there are some out there that are very concerned that your town manager, who is the strong appointing authority under your charter, will appoint the wrong person to the fire chief's position for the wrong reasons. They're also worried that the appointing authority will take the right person that's in the job and terminate them for no reason. Now, we've heard that that may not be this town manager, but that could be the next town manager. We have protections in place in the public sector that prevent many things. We certainly have protections in place for wrongful termination. So if this town manager or a new appointing authority were to come along and try and just arbitrarily fire your fire chief or your police chief if they were non-civil service, there are immediate steps that can be taken. You have protections under your town charter that allow the Board of Selectmen to veto either the appointment of the wrong person for the position or the discipline or termination of the right person for the wrong reasons. That 15-day veto period that the board can do applies. Earlier today, you also made the wise decision to add just cause language to the personnel bylaws. Surprisingly, department heads did not have any protections in the bylaws that govern them in order to have discipline or termination done to them. Now, I think counsel can speak to you about what a high legal bar it is to show just cause. So your non-civil service fire chief, if this passes today, would have that bylaw protection in place. So between the town charter and the bylaw protection, I also want to just spend another minute on if the appointing authority, your town manager, appoints the wrong person to the job. Beyond those, there's other checks and balances under the law. We all know, and many of you on boards and committees understand how stringent the Ethics Commission has become. You are very responsible to make ethical decisions. You can easily be reported, and charges can be filed when you don't. You also have conflict of interest, undue influence, as well as Mass General laws in place that also protect you from any kind of decision that is unjust. But let me switch now to a more positive thing to say about the hiring of non-civil service chiefs. Plymouth has a history of supporting internal candidate promotions. I think that I've shown you that history. I think previous town managers have shown you that, and I hope future ones do. Out of our 11 department heads, 6 were internal promotions. We have a comprehensive hiring practice in place. It started under Town Manager Mark Sylvia, and it's continued. At the department head level, we want our department heads or our potential future applicants to show us what they will really give to this community. So when we reach out for candidates, for example, for the finance director, we provide them with a comprehensive process to see if they're right for this town. First, we give them some kind of written exercise we would like them to do to show us what their writing style is like. Second, the applicants are typically asked or given some type of material, scenario, or information on the town of Plymouth, like our audit report or a financial management letter. They're asked to review it before they come into their interview and then make a presentation to a group that we put together, represents different parts of the organization, and we watch them make that presentation so we can see what they would be like standing here before you today. And then finally, we do a standard interview, usually one with a group of people, and then a one-on-one with me. So I believe, for those that questioned if we have a good appointing or hiring process in place, I believe that Plymouth does. Certainly, that changes. That process changes as we hire different department heads, as we look at what area they're coming from, the needs of the community today. If we pull these positions out of civil service, for the deputy chiefs and the fire chiefs, I would be looking at some kind of comprehensive process like that. Now, the most sensitive of the subjects that I think we'll talk about when it comes to what I'm asking you to vote today, and that is what's going on with veterans' preference. I received a phone call maybe about a month ago now from a veterans agent, and she told me that the veterans were very upset with this article, with me recommending it. So I asked if she would set up a meeting or if I could come to one of the Veterans Council's meetings to address them and tell them what we were trying to accomplish and the reasons we were trying to do this. Went to a meeting at the American Legion on a Sunday, the fire chief and I, and we spoke to the group. But they remained adamant that if we took these 3 positions out of civil service, that we would hurt veterans' preference. That really resonated with us because it was true. Removing these positions from civil service would mean they wouldn't have that civil service in place anymore that provides that veterans' preference. So we tried to put our heads together to think about what could we do. Is there something that we could come up with that would still provide veterans' preference at this level some additional points if an applicant who's a veteran applies to be chief or deputy chief in the fire department. But while we were talking about it, we said, why don't we expand this to provide some type of veterans preference to all jobs? Because we certainly believe that there are men and women coming out of the military that may want to work in public works, in environmental management, in administration. So I think what we tried to do was really good. Now, did we try and do it quickly? Sure we did. Once we thought of it, we said this is something that we should get in place because town meeting will want our assurances that if somebody in their family is going for fire chief or deputy chief, and they're a veteran, that they will get that point system that they get right now. I reached back out to the veterans agent and I said, can the fire chief meet with that group again from the Veterans Council to see what they think of our policy? We met with them on a Monday morning as quickly as we could. We showed them the draft policy and they said they made a couple changes, a couple suggestions while we were there. It's four people, the chief and I. The following evening, we brought it to an open, public, posted meeting. We didn't bring it to any kind of closed door meeting. We made sure it was televised, even though their meeting was early that night because we also had a Nuclear Regulatory Commission meeting. So when it comes to the veterans preference policy, let me tell you some of the things that it is not. It's not a precursor to eliminating civil service townwide, and I hope I covered that earlier between the protections in place and the collective bargaining agreement. It's not the first step in removing it. It's not a replacement to civil service. It does not impact the veteran's preference that's provided to a veteran applying for a job as firefighter, lieutenant, captain, battalion chief. It doesn't apply to the civil service jobs at all, and that is clearly stated in the policy. It doesn't remove preference for disabled veterans, Gold Star family members, and survivors of police officers or firefighters killed in the line of duty. We were really careful about this, which is why, as part of writing this policy, we asked the veterans agent to make this a priority in her schedule and take a look at it, because we didn't want to get any of that wrong. It doesn't impact any existing civil service veterans, any of the civil service positions. And again, I know I'm repeating, but I just want to be clear, this does not apply to non-civil service jobs. I guess we get to the crux of it here on why we want to leave civil service. At this point, I'm going to ask Chief Bradley to come up and speak to the next two slides. I just want to be clear that it is the chief's positions that have to deal with civil service every day. As your appointing authority, this is not some of the civil service bureaucracy that I have to deal with. But if you were standing in my position as the town manager in this large community, and you listened to these two chiefs for some time now, talking about the problems they have had with civil service, I do believe you would be saying the same recommendation that I am today.
Chief Bradley, continue with the presentation. Good morning.
Good morning, and thank you. Ed Bradley, your fire chief. First of all, before I even get to the slides, I just want to say to you that I am probably the most least likely candidate to ever be standing in front of you and asking you to reduce civil service in any form whatsoever. And I'll explain that to you. My father was a civil service employee. Years ago, many municipal jobs were covered under civil service. Today, it's mostly public safety, but there are a few others. My father worked for the city of Somerville. He was the director of veteran services. He provided veteran services to the people who lived in the city of Somerville. He retired with 42 years of service. As his son, obviously, I lived in a household that was protected by civil service protection. And when I graduated from Plymouth Carver Regional High School in 1973, 1 year later, I was appointed to the Plymouth Fire Department in October of 1974. Shortly thereafter, that became a full-time position. So in my 62 years, I have had the protection of civil service. This recommendation does not come lightly by me. We're just at the point where we're not getting participation, first of all, from the internal candidates, and then second of all, I've got notification from civil service that they now will not be offering a fire chief's written examination in 2017, nor in 2018, because it will put them in a deficit. They used the funds for the applicant's fee, which is $250, to devise that test, pay someone to put it together and secure it, and then to implement it and score it. And if only 54 of the fire chiefs out of 366 in the Commonwealth are in that system, I am a very, very, very small percentage of their business. Their business is at the entry level and the rank and file, which is where it should be. They should be concentrating on that. Unfortunately, I don't make up enough business for them to go out of their way. Now, recently, they have said that they're trying to come up with a new program. It would be some type of in-house assessment center. We have not seen that program. We have no idea what the product looks like. I have a little concern if they don't have the money in order to have a written examination. I don't know how they're going to get into a more complex assessment center program. But at any rate, they're working on that, but they have no date of implementation. Now, as the chief, I also want to have a succession plan. I need someone in place. Not only do I want to fill the position of deputy fire chief, but I also want to know who's getting ready to move up into my job. And I want to be able to work with those people that I identified to try to give them a heads up or give them some training so they could step into this position without having a problem. That is typically provided to me by people taking a civil service examination. We always want to have a list on the ready, whether it be for lieutenant or captain or battalion chief or deputy chief or chief, because you never know at any point in time when one of them could leave and it could be a vacant position, which there is now. Without that list standing in place, we don't have that opportunity. Now, there's been a lot of talk, and a lot of it is just to kind of muddy the water, I believe, that there's an open position now, and you could be making a provisional appointment fill that. First of all, a provisional appointment or an acting position is just kicking the can down the road. It's a Band-Aid. It's not going to fix the permanent problem, and I want to fix the permanent problem. Even if I had somebody in that position as acting, we would still be here before you today because we do not have a list to make a permanent appointment and to carry on. In the past, we have always had candidates sign up for exams, even if they didn't know there was an opening. When I took the chief's exam, there was no opening and it wasn't perceived to be one. Things changed. Actually, when they say the argument, you know, it's a lot of preparation, it's a lot of work, and if we don't know that there's an opening on the job, why would we go through that process? I would have to say for a couple of reasons. One, you want to show that you're interested so that I know who those people are. I mean, obviously, I can't try to prepare 120 people in a department to become chief. But if it's narrowed down, and that's how you get it narrowed down, show me your participation, your dedication, and take this exam, then I can work with those people and have the department in a better shape. But also, they're almost making my argument for me. They don't want to go through all that, through that process and take that, unless they know there's an opening. Well, if that's how you want to proceed on this from now on, civil service is not the system and the process to use because it's too time consuming. The reaction time is too long.
Okay. Mr. Bradley, Chapter 173, Section 5 of our town bylaws provides that a recess shall be called within every two-hour period of a session. If there are no objections from town meeting, we'll conclude the town manager's presentation, and then we'll take our recess.
I want to place this organizational chart up in front of you just to show you the complexity of this department. I think that everybody here understands, or I said earlier, it was over an $11 million budget, over 7 locations to manage and well over 100 people, has complicated personnel issues, shift management issues, dealing with the apparatus, as well as dealing with all the plans and reviewing every plan that comes before this town for new development in the community. So the concern for me, and I think for the fire chief, is knowing that with vacancies in place and coming up, how can we find another way to fill these leadership positions? And we've talked a little bit, and they've asked at caucuses, why aren't the Plymouth firefighters taking these civil service exam? I can only guess at that and go by what I've heard to date, but they're very difficult. These tests, I think about 100 questions. I think for Deputy Chief, the Chief told me you answer about 80 of them. They're the little bubble fill-in. They're not easy, and they're a ton of work to study for. They're also expensive for the men and women to take. And the Chief was saying earlier, will you take them even if there's no vacancy? I listened to a firefighter the other night to say, you know, it's like a practice test. If we take the test and there's no vacancy, and then the list can expire, and we have to spend the $1,000 all over again. It's also a gap in time from when you take the test to when you get the results. It's also, in my opinion, could be a fear of failing the test. There's a test coming up, I think May 13th this year, with firefighters signed up to take that test. But what if it results in none of them passing or two of them passing? I mean, I think that that can be a concern, or all of the above. Unfortunately, this is the way civil service operates. This is the system we are under. I just ask that you support Article 11. It's failing the town. I think it's failing the employees. I think that we can find leaders from within our department, from within the fire department, in a different manner than civil service is doing for us now. So I would hope, after you hear both sides of this and we answer any questions you have, you'll support us moving away from civil service for these three positions. Thank you.
At this time, we will take a 15-minute recess. This session stands in recess at 10:01 a.m. Thank you.